And welcome to another edition of Carnivore Radio. I'm your host, Jeff Sherman. We have Marty Keenan in Studio B, as well as Chris Calandra. We have a action-packed show, I hope. And, please call in whatever's on your mind. Gentlemen, it's kind of one of those days where you kind of feel like loosey-goosey and whatever goes. But on a serious note, Mr. Keenan, it is our fun drive. So why should people go to WESU/pledge and make it happen?
Well, for our return listeners, I think they recognize, at least at this time of day on a Friday afternoon, they know that Carnivore Radio is going to be here offering them an opportunity to call in and participate in a dialogue. And then outside of that, you've got a matching gift activity going on right now. We're only $6,000 short from a particular goal in mind where we'll get a matching fund of $5,000. So if we could get some people to participate in that, we might even be able to ramp up our totals a little bit.
I would agree. And Chris, why should people go to WESUFM.org/pledge?
Because it supports Wesleyan University, one of the great universities in the state of Connecticut, and it supports community radio, so you get different views on various topics. We got an outstanding lineup up and down the calendar on the station, and it gives you a different viewpoint than the major cable networks, and you
Can
want that
you
local
a question
presence.
About that?
Yeah.
Because I used to be a news junkie. And this is an erudite question for you, Chris, and Marty, you can comment after that. Is I'm kind of sick of the news, Chris.
Are you?
I mean, I'm sick of mainstream media.
I agree with that.
I think it completely friggin' sucks. And I don't get liberals tuning into MSNBC because it's the same thing for me. When I tune into Fox and listen to the meathead, Sean, it's just boring.
Yeah.
The crap that just spoon feeding you crap that you want to hear. How interesting is that? It's fascinating.
Yeah. And if you watch MSNBC or Fox News and you tune in at 9 o'clock in the morning or 10 o'clock and then you come home at the end of the day and you turn it on, they're probably talking about the same stuff.
Over. And how do you do over and over? And then you watch CNN, which Dr. Lopkin and I were talking about last week. And I don't care about partisan politics. I could care less, right? Zucker. First Chris, then Marty. Did he destroy that brand or what? He had the greatest opportunity to, I know niche marketing, yes. You know, so you have MSNBC, Super Lib, and then you have Fox, conservative plus whatever, okay? Wide open. This one opportunity where the middle, there's a marketing term, gentlemen, called stuck in the middle, that's usually not good. But in this case, stuck in the middle would have been amazing as they get their 15%, and you get this 50%. You had a brand identity of the leader, and this moron, who according to Lopkin screwed up NBC and blah, 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 who cares about it? Did he screw it up or not?
Oh, I think he definitely did. And as a quick side note, I think they did reshuffle some management at MSNBC because of the falling ratings. And are you sure, Marty, what do you think? Are you sure you're not just upset that they haven't called and invited you to have your own show on
well,
one of those
should,
networks?
Because I'd be much better. Okay.
Good point, Marty.
We're coming along for the ride, Jeff.
You ain't getting
out of here without us.
The coattails are freshly painted there, freshly pressed.
Anyway, I used to watch CNN. I used to love it. When I first got back here from Philly, I used to watch. You had Crossfire, and then you had Larry King, and then you had another show. It was excellent.
Mm-hmm. I think the numbers are going down because people are tired, as you say, that, you know, this is the same old story.
Yeah, but have a lineup, Marty, too.
True.
Anderson.
There's not a lot of talent.
2 hours, boring. What's that? Jay Tapper, the genius, and then they got Lemon.
Yeah.
Another genius. It's awful. And I don't care if you hate that. It's fine. You may think Trump is a Russian spy and the worst. How can you listen to, like, 5 hours? Like, I can't listen to how Trump is the greatest and and even when Obama was Obama's, how can you listen to that crap? And I think our news is over with.
Yeah, no, I would. I would agree with that. Like you said, it's the news thing, but it's also.
I'd love what a caller, if a caller could comment at 860-685-7700, 685-7700, 685-7700. Is the news over? I'm sorry, you were saying something, Chris, my bad.
No, I think, like you said, it's more of the same. They don't have enough really stuff to talk about for 24/7, and they also lack talent.
But isn't it laziness, Marty? Because instead of having an investigative journalism, let's really find out. Mm-hmm. I don't know. What is the Russian thing all about? What is this all? It's just always the usual suspects, Tom, Dick, and Harry, right?
Yep.
And whoever network it is. And if you're MSNBC, they're going to tell you that Trump not only did, you know, is involved with Putin in Russia, but he also has ties to Chairman Mao, even though he's been dead for 40 years.
Right.
And then if you're going to watch Fox, it never happened and blah, blah, blah. I mean, but there's no, it's just very easy to do. It's all prepackaged. You don't learn anything.
No, you don't learn anything. And as you say, the numbers of viewership is going down because people are tired of it. CNN had an opportunity, as you say, to, you know, repackage information and maybe even go in a different direction because people in some ways are tired of listening to it, which in a lot of ways is dangerous because that gives more power to those that are making those terrible decisions. And if you start to lose interest and you get involved, you know, not in the democratic process anymore, you know, that adds to the angst of authoritarianism. So, you know, you want an active press, but at the same time, their activity is so focused that it's turning people off.
Mm-hmm. So, what do you, I'll first, Chris, then Marty, where do you think this plays out? I have my own view, but so I think, here's what I think. One thing, MSNBC, and to some degree, CNN, And I'm not dismissing Fox or giving them free passes just because there wasn't the opportunity. The opportunity for both those networks is to bash Trump. I think MSNBC put everything into that. Rachel Maddow was like a rock star. And I actually do believe the analysis, I often don't, that she put all her eggs in one basket, that Mueller was going to find collusion and blood, and Trump was going to come out in handcuffs. And when it didn't happen, I think her audience became disillusioned. First, Chris.
Yeah, and not entertained. You know, I mean, a lot of people tune into these shows in part to get the news. But, like, you know, my mom and dad, who are retired now, I mean, they sit down and they watch the news at night. It's entertainment. They don't watch sitcoms. They don't watch dramas. They sit down and they watch it. They do need to be entertained. And I don't think any of these shows entertained. I think Bill O'Reilly's show is the last one.
Bill O'Reilly, that, you know, something, he has a bad rap. I'm not talking about the whatever.
Extracurricular activities.
I'm not talking about that. But no, he was an intellectual person that actually debated the issue.
And he had star power. I mean, he had a popular fan base.
He wasn't afraid to put a super lib on and actually have a discussion.
Yeah. Right. No,
Chris Wallace is like that a little bit, and Jon Stewart's like that a little bit.
But Chris Wallace isn't on except for Sundays, though.
Yeah, Sunday.
So who's on Fox News at night? I don't even know anymore.
Well,
Sean Hannity.
My favorite. Any intellectualism is Tucker Carlson. I mean, that's the only, you know, for me, I cannot watch CNN and MSNBC. It's just too much. And I don't watch a lot of Fox either. It's just,
no.
I mean, Tucker Carlson, he's got, you know, it's not all about Trump and about, he has social issues. He's probably the best of all of them.
I watch very little Fox News. I used to enjoy watching Bill O'Reilly's show. And I can't remember the last time I watched Fox News for more than like 5 minutes.
I'm saying when I do.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't really.
No, I know.
I tune out. But, I just can't. Because, I mean, it's, you know, it was maybe. And it's been going on for like 6-10 years of the same crap. All the networks.
Yeah.
You know,
why don't we put in our resumes?
I think that would be probably the most interesting thing, because I think they do need new talent.
Huge.
No, like someone brand new, and I can't believe, Marty, I don't know if you ever watched the show, why they don't try to get another, God, I forgot his name. What the hell is a senior moment? Larry King.
Mm-hmm. Well, even outside of the more traditional styles. Yeah,
like
absolutely. But a show like ours, right? Give us a week, and there's other people around the country
yeah.
that have the same kind of shows that we do. Find us, give us a week, bring in another group of guys. Give them a week. Rotate us through on a monthly basis, and people will get an opportunity to hear people from
yeah.
Connecticut, from Iowa, maybe from Montana,
or
whatever.
I like your idea of maybe. But here's a problem, Marty.
It'd be like a little
Chris,
menu.
The problem is no one's willing to take a chance. That's one of the reasons why music sucks and why the media sucks, because they're not going to take a chance on Marty Keene. It's never going to happen. But they'll do the same old usual suspects.
Sure.
And you're going to get the same crap. Even like analysts. Donna Brazile. Why is she an analyst? Could you please tell me?
I have no idea.
She, by the way, I voted
former for chairman of the National Democratic yeah. Party.
Well, yes.
Yeah. You know, I mean, she had status at some point.
Okay. She is not ready for prime time. And why I say that is, I voted for Gore. She ran Gore's campaign. You could have had Keith Richards do it better. She sucked. He had every reason to win,
yep.
and that moron ran his campaign. One debate, he's all aggressive. The next, he's like on Prozac. It was
yeah.
pathetic.
Then he comes out and he wears like flannels one
flannels
week, and then he goes back to a suit
looked
the next
like
week.
He's like a mental patient. I mean, and she's the ex. You're
right.
not an expert. You screw. Same thing with Madeline.
Yeah, Mary Madeline.
Mary Madeline.
Right.
She screwed up. Bush. Bush Senior, who should have won, and yeah. she's the well, she's you know her time has passed. But there was like a 5-year road. She was a mm-hmm. run that she was on the show. All you know, all these shows. You're not an expert. You screwed it up.
Yep. So you want to see some fresh blood up
yeah.
and down?
Yes, and we do invite our callers. Do you think they should have fresh blood on any of these networks? 860.
How about Hope Hicks?
685-7700. 860-685-7700. And, you know, I think my assertion is correct, both first Chris and Marty, that they're not willing to take a chance, which
no.
they should, because there's nothing to lose.
If any one of the networks, any one of the three cable networks, or the three cable networks, if they could find somebody that's fresh, charismatic, dynamic, that would really, you know, has that star power, they would kill it. And it could
kill
be a
it.
Liberal, could be a Democrat,
but
could be somebody in between.
You're a successful guy. I get it, right?
Yeah.
But you're not, in, you know, you're not a media mogul, right? How does Zucker have the job and you just, why don't you have it? In other words, it's kind of
it's a huge
I'm sorry,
payoff.
Not taking anything away
yeah,
from, it's kind of common sense.
Absolutely, because it'd be a huge payoff because the field is so weak. You could have somebody to suck up all the energy and get viewers.
Fox did try with that English guy, the bald guy. He's on Sunday. He really sucks, but I forgot drain the swamp. You know, he tried, and he's not a super conservative. Now, I will say that. Sometimes in life, you get lucky just for – I have to comment because Marty wouldn't know him. Sean Hannity, how lucky did he get?
Oh, yeah. Right place, right time. No doubt about it.
No doubt about it.
Because he started – like because you're referring, I think he started on 9/11.
And I think he just filled in. He was a local guy, but he filled in for Rush because he was in New York. But, you know, whatever. God bless him. But, Marty, do you agree that they need a complete fresh blood?
Well – absolutely. So my idea would you know shake things up a little
bit. I like
bit.
That.
And
do like Star Search.
Absolutely. So you know we have America's Got Talent. You know America has ideas.
Oh yeah.
And you know we should be able to share those kinds of things.
And
like
to
that.
Your point, you have a great farm system because if you go through the podcast world, I listen to a lot of podcasts. You know I have a podcast. Lots of people have podcasts. Jeff has a podcast. You could go through and research and find some people that are...
And who has a following a little bit.
Yeah.
Something that's interesting.
And give them a shot. And then have a little... You can make it even a fun competition kind of thing like you said. You get one night, kind of like on Johnny Carson, you'd have a comedian. And if you did well on Carson's show, you'd blow up. You could do something like that. I think it would kill it with the ratings.
No, I would agree with that. And I think they need a guy also, not him, but a guy like Alex Jones, something controversial. Something interesting. We do have a caller. Caller, are you there?
Yes, sir.
So what say you?
Well, you know, I was thinking about the future, you know.
We all do, and it's bleak. Anyway, go ahead.
Interested in the future, what science will be like in the future and everything. And I was wondering about the population and how we could locate a lot of people on the corridor between New York City and Boston and develop it to its maximum, you know, capability to house people. For example, there's another place like that in Shanghai.
Well, that sounds good because we always need real estate development. Very good. I like that. Thank you very much. That's awesome. Thank you.
That's, you know, scientific. It's not just, you know, willy-nilly put the, you know, housing here or whatever, but you really got to be the science of
I agree. With science is lacking. Marty, don't you think that we need a little more science in our everyday life?
Well, absolutely, but, you know, half the time we're denying science. So, yeah, I think there should certainly be more attributed to science. But, you know, science offers us a lot. I think there's a lot of topical areas that information is expanding a lot faster than people's knowledge of it. So there's a bit of an information explosion out there, and certainly science is playing a role in it.
I gotcha, no doubt. Politically, I think it's interesting. Chris, I'll go to you first. I believe, well, it's nothing radical either, Trump has no one in his administration that has any clue. Why would you go on Stephanopoulos to begin with? Answer that question first.
Personally, I like that he does that, because if you want a president that's going to deal with these bad actors and tough people around the world, you know, he should be able to handle a media guy. I don't think Stephanopoulos is a fair arbiter. No, but I do like that Donald Trump does interviews with people.
I would
be prepared, which he doesn't do.
That's what I'm saying. You'd say, would you take information from a foreign? You probably don't want to say that, correct?
I think it's the hubris that his way, his gut, his actions, and everything that he does, he's so convinced is the right way to do it that he doesn't really, you know, think about those kinds of things, because he feels as though he's been so successful just operating at that level.
I wouldn't argue with that.
I would agree with that. I will say, and perhaps this is me with my bias being a Trump cheerleader, Marty, though. Do you mean to tell me if Nancy Pelosi got a call from a foreign operative that said, hey, I have some information about Donald Trump, that she wouldn't take the call, or Hillary Clinton wouldn't have done that?
No. So everyone would take the call. And if they said no, they're lying.
That's
But given the do I think it's the end of the world? No.
Yeah.
But given what he's just been through
Agreed.
2 years, probably say, no, I'd refer to the FBI. And just, but right. Everyone
yeah.
would take the information.
Yeah, and
well, taking the call and taking the information are two different things.
Well,
call and then realizing who it is, then you make your decision on what you're going to do. But listening to the phone call, that's the problem.
But again, perhaps it's my bias. You know, a lot of this stuff, though, is there are Russian intelligence people in and around this country. But, you know, when they call you up, they don't say, hey, by the way, I get paid by Putin. Mm. I think some of this dialogue now in this get Trump kind of thing, I think makes it seem much simpler than it is. And a lot of these bad actors, you don't know what team they're on or what angle they're playing.
There is no one in politics that wouldn't listen and basically see what is going on. I'm sure Hillary did that. Everyone's done it, so it's really no shock. A caller, are you there?
I am.
And what did say you?
You're basically saying the Steele document.
Yeah, of course. Hello. I mean, yeah, duh. Yeah, hello. So do you think that basically if Hillary got the call that she would, hang up and call the FBI?
No. You'd look at the information. You might notify the FBI as well, but you'd still look at the information and see if you could use it.
Yeah, there's no question about it. Do you think Trump was really ill? Do you think Trump Here's what I think, and he's commented. I think Trump has lightweights in his administration, not in all departments like Pompeo, he's a heavyweight, others, but in terms of strategically advising him about political matters, he doesn't have like a Jim Baker. I think, number one, it's dumb to go on Stephanopoulos' show. He's a political operative. He's not. He's got an agenda. They all do, but he has a real agenda. And then also to say that you would take the call, of course you would take the call, but say no. Obviously, it's just common sense, isn't it?
The biggest problem that his administration has is their business people, and they don't understand that you can't do certain things in politics.
Agreed. I agree with
that.
The
guy's using their administrators to help them get tickets for something. That's what assistants do in the business world.
I would agree. So let me ask you a question. Are you following the political landscape right now?
Vaguely.
I'm going to ask the gentleman in Studio B, but I'll ask you first to kind of tee it up, to use a sports metaphor here. Overused one, by the way. What do you think of Biden? Do you think he really does have a 15-point lead? And what kind of candidate do you think he'll be?
I think we went from the last administration, everyone making fun of him for not knowing anything, to now they think he can win a presidency, and it won't work.
Yeah, I think, number one, the polls, first of all, I've been through many polls, not personally, obviously, but I've observed this time, Bob Dole was 20 points ahead of Clinton. He lost by the biggest, like it was like a disaster. In fact, Clinton was actually feeling sorry for him at the end. The polls don't mean anything. I believe that, not just wishful thinking, I think Biden does not hold up under scrutiny. Caller, first you.
I as well do not think that
he's
also
making
and
a fool of
polls,
himself.
Polls, you have to look at who they use. Who do they poll? They poll the same people all the time that say the same thing all the time.
I would agree. So first, Chris, then Marty, what do you think of the Biden phenomenon?
So assuming, caller, that you're more of a Trump fan than a Trump detractor, do you like that he does interviews with unfriendly, if you will, media sources like George Stephanopoulos, or would you prefer him to stay on friendly territory like interviewing with Fox media personalities?
I think that he should interview with all across the ranges. The biggest problem he has is he shoots from the hip without, I guess, thinking his answers through in terms of, as a business person, it's always, yeah, everything is great. Even if your business is failing, you don't tell anybody that.
Yeah, it's exactly right.
There's nothing wrong with a press conference either, you know. Answer questions from the American people. That wouldn't be such a bad idea.
Yeah. I like that he does the press, and you're right about him answering it like a business person, but it's an interesting phenomenon, isn't it? Because
actually,
that's also part of
quite a lot, doesn't he?
His way to a helicopter. It's not a press conference.
I think he does less press now than he did earlier. And I think part of his success during the campaign is he did a lot of press. But part of his charm is he doesn't sound like a politician. And I think that's one of the things that I like.
Too polished,
but
forget about it.
But you know, the answer to George Stephanopoulos' question was, you know, George, I appreciate the question, but I can't deal with hypotheticals. I really don't think that would happen. And I don't know what I would do if it happened, but it's a hypothetical.
So what do you think of the Biden phenomenon as well?
I think that Biden is in the lead because
Trump.
Of name recognition, but I really don't think it'll stand up once this competition gets heated up and the numbers get whittled down, that the Democratic Party will want someone newer, fresher.
I think it'll be a fresh face.
I think so, too.
Marty, do you think it'll be a fresh face?
I concur with Chris in terms of the fact that it's a name that we know or people do recognize when you have a field of candidates of into the almost 26 people. You know, so they see those names, and that's where I think he's riding it right now. And maybe the caller was right in terms of the people that are polling. You know, you don't know what their population is, what the survey is. And, you know, so there's lots of variables. But it's early in the game, and I think we're all right on this one.
Cool.
One thing too, with the caller, we're going to transition. Caller, are you still there?
I am.
What do you think of the recent development in the Gulf with the tanker? How do you think? Do you think Iran's actually responsible? And what do you think happens next?
I don't know if Iran is responsible or not.
Okay.
The results are crude oil prices are going up, and I think that was the results whoever did it was looking for.
I think actually you're not wrong. I mean, there's the that factor, you know, the shock factor, but I also think yes, that was also a plays a role. Any other final thoughts, my friend?
The video supposedly of the Iranian guard installing the limpet mines, mm-hmm. or deinstalling the limpet mines.
Yes,
it's like we weren't putting them on; we're taking them off. That's yeah. just a comical thing. I don't know how it went for real.
Do you know one thing I'm very leery of? Because yeah, I don't know if you remember this, but after right after 9/11, and Colin Powell, who always gets a free pass, was in front of the UN with this. If you read the transcripts, because I actually saw it live, was so pathetic about it. It was all, you know, put the nuclear rods in the truck, Mohammed. The American dog is coming. It was a joke. So I don't think people. I think people are very leery of trusting the government in terms of getting us into another conflict. Do you agree with that, caller?
Yes, the government does what it wants for the reasons it wants, not for what it seems like they want.
Exactly, all the way going back to the Gulf of Tonkin. All right, you have a great weekend.
You as well.
Take care.
Well, because certainly John Bolton has been identified as somebody who would like to rub the noses of the Iranians, and Pompeo is certainly no dove, so... You know, I know that the president has always spoken in terms of not wanting to get America involved again, but,
sure.
you know, the two advisors that he does have that are hardball players, you know, are in charge of this particular incident. So,
yeah.
You know, Jeffrey's right in terms of who are some of these people, and they kind of lead him down the road.
Bolton,
but with his hubris,
I agree with you, Mr. Keena, yeah. is, I'm sorry, I know he's deceased, but I was never a big fan of John McCain because he never... Him and Lindsey Graham never met a conflict they didn't like. Bolton's pretty close to that.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's
oh,
like...
Oh, he could hang with those guys.
It's like Bridgeport did something wrong. We should bomb it. Yeah, he's...
He should have been the mayor of Philly.
There you go, yeah. No, he's a little out there. But we do have a little break now, and I'll throw it up to you, Chris, first, and Marty. Again, it's our pledge drive. It's $5,000 matching gift in effect. Why should callers go to WESUFM.org/pledge? We only need $6,000 left. Why should they do that?
Because I like coming here on Friday, hanging out with you guys, talking on the radio, and
I should
love
ask,
it.
Should ask the callers why they call in.
Yeah.
You know,
and I love the callers. Yeah, heck yeah, I love the callers.
The callers what makes the show.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
Without callers.
We've been blessed with them.
Yeah.
And you know what it is, though? I agree. You know something? If we were actually on CNN... I believe we would crush it.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
No, I'm not.
You notice we're included now?
Absolutely. We just have to put those pronouns out there.
Yes. No, I think we would, because
it would be definitely. I think we would crush it.
We get such a wide range of people that call in, and you could tell, you know, different ages. We have men call in, women call in. We have different viewpoints. I think we even once had it. Self-described anarchist call into the, mm-hmm. you know, when was the last time Rachel Maddow had an anarchist call into her show?
Well, that's the thing, they're so boring.
Yeah.
Because it's just over, yes, Trump is the worst thing, or Trump is the greatest thing. It's like, it's boring.
Yeah, and it's gotten heated from time to time with callers over the years, but for the vast majority of time, we have constructive, healthy, respectful conversations, good banter back and forth, and I would love to see more of that.
When's the last time you saw Sean?
Oh,
because I watch it sometimes when I go to bed, like 10 minutes, not a lot, like 10 minutes because nothing else on. And it's like big exclusive. He always says that. No.
Breaking news.
And it's like something like it's a Russia hoax. Like, okay.
Yeah. No, I mean, from start to finish, I haven't watched it in years and years and years. I'm more apt to be like, you know, maybe put it on 5 minutes before, you know, I change to go out or something like that. But I'm not going to sit down and watch that show. I've never, ever liked his show in particular, besides Marty. And you're probably not a fan of his either on the philosophical front. But I could listen to him and he'd start to ask a question. I could go down, get in my car, drive 15 minutes across town, get to my friend's house, turn on the show, and he hasn't finished the question. I have no tolerance for that whatsoever.
Oh, man. It's crazy.
So who do you like? If you were to watch something at night that's news-oriented, is there somebody that you like, or is there somebody you could point to and say, boy, that show is just not informative, not entertaining.
Well,
I don't see how they have that gig.
It's not a person. Like, I'll turn on the BBC.
Okay.
Because I like to get more of an international flavor You know, so I'll get stuff from Singapore. I'll get something from London. I'll get
You're such a renaissance man.
You know, so
that's a good answer.
That kind of thing. And then also Vice News. I know that might have a little bit of a left-leaning slant. But Vice News, I mean, they do go in-depth onto some of these topics.
I thought Vice did all kinds of like...
I'm sorry?
I like Vice. But you have to suspend reality not to think they're hard left.
I didn't say that. I said you wanted news that was kind of a little bit thoughtful and investigative.
And they are more creative.
That they are very interesting when they do something. Yes, when they do something like the drugs in America, I've seen a couple others, that they're maybe the only major outlet that actually they have an agenda. Everyone does. But I agree with Marty that they do a good job.
Yeah. And that's that investigative journalism. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's a good answer.
Yep.
But there's nothing like, and that's a very splintered, they don't have many viewers, but there's no major network that's really doing it.
No. But I also think that, as you mentioned earlier about all the different podcast opportunities, there's so many different ways that people are getting their information now.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and, you know, as much as I'm a newspaper guy and I will never stop getting the newspaper, you know, I'm a dinosaur in that regard. And so everybody is getting their news from different ways. We talk about the tribalism from the different networks. So, you know, people, as we say, have gravitated to their point of view, and there's very few of us out there that are more of a gestalt and try to see the whole thing. And, you know, some people just stay in their lane.
Hey, Jeff, could we go back to something you asked a caller about?
Go ahead.
So you have these attacks in the Gulf of Hormuz, which is a very sensitive area. I don't know what the percentage is, but it's really high, the amount of oil.
Oh, can I interject one thing real quick? Is because of recent policies being energy independent, we don't get a heart attack now of this incident.
That's what I was going to say. You know, it's a highly sensitive area. It's been talked about for years.
But it's not as sensitive as it used to be because we're energy independent.
So what's your thought? In a month from now, will we even remember that this happened, or is this going to be something that flares up problems in the Middle East? Is this a forget about it kind of thing,
it
or something serious?
It should be a forget about it. I agree with Marty that Bolton in particular, I don't think he really has the trust of Trump, because Trump's not an interventionist. I like your point. I think it's a tempest in a teapot because of our energy standing. Yes, but if we 5, 6, 10 years ago, it would be top 24/7 news, rightfully so, because and the stock market, to your point before the show started, would be down 500 points today.
Now, I wonder where the oil was coming from. So let's say, was it Saudi oil? So now if it was Saudi oil, they're going to be upset because obviously with the Shiite.
But the initial point, though, is before we move on to that, do you agree with that if it was 6, 10 years ago, stock market down at least 500 points?
Absolutely.
I think that's true. I think it's a very fair point that with U.S. finding more oil on our soil and with fracking, that we're much more energy independent and it's not as big a deal as it once was. And with what Marty is saying is, I think it was a Norwegian tanker and a Japanese tanker, but I didn't see anything about where
Japanese
the oil...
Tanker, I just heard this. I'm not trying to be rude or interrupt. Is that the Prime Minister of Japan was in Iran during that incident.
Right. It was almost like a World War II kind of moment, when
I did not
Pearl Harbor was getting bombed.
This morning that whatever... A prime minister or a leading governmental official from Japan.
Yeah, Prime Minister Abe.
Was in Iran.
Huh.
And I don't know. Was it a signal? Because they're supporting more of the American policies.
Yeah.
Maybe it was like, don't go too far.
So what do you think, Marty? In a month from now, is this just a forget about it kind of moment, or is this something that
No, I think there's people over there that are looking for a proxy fight. They're looking to – the Saudis are wicked aggressive. I mean, look what they've been doing to Yemen. You know, they certainly have the capability. They have the support of the United States. You know, I don't know where Turkey plays in on this one, but I know the Saudis and the Iranians, they're looking for a reason to go
Actually,
at it.
Actually, Marty, that's a very good point. That might be the next, not Israel and someone else.
Yeah.
Could be Saudi, Iran as the next
right
thriller in Manila.
Yeah, that would be terrible.
What do you think about that, Chris?
That would be bad all around. That's dangerous stuff. But yeah, that's awfully plausible. I mean,
it's
could totally see that happen.
Especially if they get the, I don't know, what was it, like $35 billion worth of our stuff?
Yeah, the Saudis are very, very good customers. You talk about the military-industrial complex, and you look it up on Wikipedia, and they have the Saudis there. But go back to Bolton for a second, because try this on. You know, because Bolton is, I think, a war hawk. I mean, he's a tough guy.
Yeah.
And but I think Donald Trump, and again, this might be from my bias because I hold President Trump in high regard, but I think he likes him because I think he does bad cop, good cop all the time. I think he goes into meetings and say, hey, listen, you know, I love you. We like your personal relationship, this, that, the other thing. But let me tell you, when I talk to John Bolton, he wants me to unleash the Sixth Fleet on you.
Chris, well done.
And he's going to harass the heck out of me when we leave here.
Singing Kumbaya all
can,
the time.
Yeah, can you give me something so that I could back John Bolton off?
With the Obama administration? Okay. Did anyone shake in their boots during the Obama
administration? No, because they didn't have a bad guy.
John Kerry. Oh, God, I'm scared.
And listen, I am not a tough guy by any stretch of the imagination. But, you know, if you're in a scrape, you know who you want with you? The crazy guy that nobody knows what's going to happen.
Agreed.
I
don't think Trump's an interventionist. I don't think that it's going to happen. I think what we talked about is absolutely true, that because we're energy independent, there's no real need, unless it escalates into craziness. But the Strait of Hormuz, it is a minimal impact. 10 years ago, it was a huge impact.
Yeah. And I think it's more than oil. I think there's a huge percentage of most commercial shipping that kind of does that, sort of like the Panama Canal of that part of the world.
Escalating. If it moves on to that, that's another whole nother.
Yeah, it's quite a pinch point. Yep.
Yes. So, it is the beginning of the summer.
Yeah.
We talked about this before.
School's out for summer.
I was watching some, a little bit of baseball. And it's interesting. You know, it's nice to watch. I like it on, you know, watch a little bit on TV. It's nice. But a lot of empty seats out there.
A lot of empty seats out there. And we've talked about it on and off for the show. But I'll jump ahead of you on this. I think it was last week, maybe the week before, for the first time ever, lacrosse was on major news network.
Yeah.
It was on, I think it was on NBC, I think. It was the first time ever you had lacrosse on, and I think that's a harbinger of more to come with lacrosse.
Fascinating.
That was the Major League Lacrosse.
Yeah, Major League Lacrosse.
I believe that, okay, before baseball, there was something else. I don't know what it was, right? 1850, whatever. I believe it just can't. It has to happen that there'll be basketball safe, football safe, but it's never. It's reached its apex.
Yeah, and actually, I'm such a geek. But in the U.S., it used to be very popular to watch rowing. Could you imagine that rowing?
When?
Like the 1900s into the 1930s.
Yeah, special viewing trains.
Yeah, absolutely. Rowing, boxing, and horse racing.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah, I agree.
Those
so
are the big
you know,
three.
Nothing stays forever. I think baseball, no one plays it, no kids. No.
Sure.
I mean, yeah, Dominican and all, yes, I got that, and that's a big part of the game. I think besides New York, Chicago, say, you know, like the big six.
Yeah.
It's in trouble.
Absolutely.
And it's also unsustainable for these salaries.
Right.
Yes. Yep.
Unsustainable.
So, and I think the participation really depends on, it's almost a regional thing. You know, you watch ESPN, those college teams, they're getting their players from somewhere, you know, and even the Connecticut's state championships, some of those kids that just finished up their high school careers, they're going off to Notre Dame, they're going off to Florida State. So there is some, you know, talent out there, and I think it will sustain itself because it's a huge business. You know, they get their corporate money from television.
Under changing conditions.
You know, you can't keep giving players $400 million.
We do have a caller on the line. Caller, are you there?
Yes, I am.
What say you?
Well, I want to comment on, first I'll comment on sports. Just recently we saw how women's sports are endangered because of transgender men participating in women's sports. We saw it in Connecticut field, in the field events. For the state championship, that jeopardized Title IX and women's sports, because it's no longer women's sports when you have men competing against women, and biologically,
I think that's something that will be more in the news. I would agree. Yes.
Yeah, I think
it will destroy women's sports if it's left unchecked.
How about sports, like major sports? We were talking about baseball. Do you think its best days are over?
Oh, absolutely. It's too long. I mean, you have too many breaks. You have too many people taking 10 minutes to hit a ball.
I think it's unsustainable. I used to play baseball when I was younger. I watched games. We used to have Saturday afternoon, game of the week. I would go over to my friend's house, and it would be Kansas City against New York, whatever. And we'd watch the whole game.
And it was only an hour and a half long.
Less than it is now. I think that it is unsustainable with the salaries. Yeah, there's big market teams.
Not salaries, because young people are not into baseball.
Not at all.
That's the problem.
And then you know something? You know what the average age of a baseball fan is?
54.
Well, close enough. 55, same thing. Yeah, 55, which is ancient.
Yep.
In marketing terms. So I think it's unsustainable. Basketball is sustainable, more than sustainable. Football is. Hockey is always going to be where it is. Do you think that, like Chris was saying, that maybe lacrosse, do you think another sport could bump out?
Well, the only other sport that's likely to bump it out is soccer, and that's the only one.
You might have a point.
And because young people, if you pass by any field at any given day, you're going to see young people playing soccer.
Yes, and also with changing demographics, more Hispanics. It was happening anyway. But I think you're right. And I think, I don't know, I think soccer, I know they don't score every 5 seconds, but a lot more interesting.
The women's soccer team scores every 5 seconds.
But I mean, a lot more interesting than baseball.
But I was really calling to comment on two things.
Yeah.
One is Trump made the right response. And the reason I say that is because that question was so loaded. Had he said, I wouldn't meet with the Russians, I wouldn't take dirt from anybody else, and I would call the FBI. Those are three things that his son did not do when he met with Anna Poblyach, whatever her name is. Those are three things his son didn't do. So the next likely question would be, if you believe that, why didn't your son do that? Which is a loaded question, and he don't have a problem. He didn't have a problem answering the question. He answered it honestly. He said he would, but yet the Democrats are attacking him. MSNBC, CNN was attacking him. Fox is attacking him. But yet, just going back a few months ago, Alan Schiff actually was pranked.
Oh yes, no question. Yes, very good point. Schiff, who's a whack job, by the way. Yes, he actually got a call. That's right. That was really interesting. And he was so dumb.
And
it was so obvious. It was hello. And he goes, okay, we'll meet. He got a call. Who would they say they were from? Russia?
No, from Ukraine.
And said we have dirt on Trump. And he goes, okay, yeah. And then do you know what really sucks about the new Democratic Party? I bet you, because I can't stand the guy, but I bet you Schiff was on some show, probably MSNBC, saying how outraged he is about that comment. When you're right, caller, he took the call from the Ukraine thinking it was from the Ukraine. He's so dumb.
And the sad part about it is that Trump was being honest. When you guys on your panel today even said that you should be dishonest when you answer that question, which showed his contrast. And the second thing I want to bring up is the polls. It's not the methodology that's the problem with the polls that they're getting today and probably in 15 and 16. It's not the methodology. It's just people are reluctant to express their support for Trump. Nixon was right. There is a solid majority out there. And the problem with that is that you don't see any Trump bumper stickers. You don't see any signs in people's yard. You don't see a hat. You don't have people going to social events or business events talking about support for Trump. They just refuse to do it.
Actually, I think that's an excellent point, caller. I've met people, right, initial meetings,
right.
And they've actually told me, oh, I can't stand Trump. And then I got to actually know them, and they're like, yeah, he's actually pretty good. Faux pas that you can't say that you support him. I agree with you.
And once they get in the voting booth, that's a different story. I would predict today that Trump will win by a larger margin in 2020 than he did before, because there's a lot of people out here that support Trump, but they are reluctant because they're afraid of being vilified and chastised in any social or business event by supporting him.
I actually think you have an excellent point, because I think, first of all, I also think, now Marty might be right that, you know, that there's someone coming, you know, in the wings. Biden does not hold up in prime time. It's all like you think, oh, this guy got invited to a party. He's going to make the party so much better. I'm talking about like using a euphemism. But he, from the last month, he has no energy. I don't know what the heck he's talking about. He's all over the map. He's taken back every position he's ever had. I don't see it holding up in prime time. Do you?
No, absolutely not.
And in a debate with Trump, it'd be embarrassing.
The problem with the Democrats, either they go with Joe or they go with somebody so far to the left that they cannot support Middle America.
I agree. That's their dilemma. That's why it's got to be someone that we don't know yet, because that is absolutely correct. If it's not Biden, then the rest of them are so far, though they're great in the Democratic Party, because that's what the Democratic Party is now. It's a hard-left socialist party. But in mainstream America, they're dead.
Their only hope is Bloomberg.
Bloomberg would be...
He stands a chance. But
Marty, what do you think of Bloomberg?
He was my guy, and then he decided to drop out. Because,
but wouldn't he have been good?
Oh, my God, yeah. Absolutely. Because de Blasio's got no choice.
He's liberal but sane. These people they have now are liberal and insane, Chris.
Yeah, and he's got the business chops.
Yes, he would be a good, great call. Thank you very much. That was a great call. Bloomberg would have been very, very, unlike Biden, I'm sorry, that's just like wishful thinking. He would have been a big foil against Trump.
Yeah, well,
I think so.
Say he won't get drafted in?
No, you never know. So let's go into news items.
Well, one of the things that one of our callers called in today about, you know, housing and population and such, but I didn't know if you guys knew that the birth rate in the United States has fallen for the fourth year in a row.
Oh, yeah. It's all over the Western world. And every Western country.
So all the development.
Yes, every Western country in the developed world, their birth rates are way down.
Yep. So that's certainly going to have an impact down the road in terms of
many
different things. Absolutely. And not just, in 10 or 15 years. I think, you know, they're starting to deal with it now.
And it's why we do need immigration.
Yeah.
But
I think sane immigration system.
Right. Right.
Yes.
And so, you know, part of that, you know, kind of decline in population is the fact that the kids are owing so much money, you know, coming out of college that they really can't make the investment in families and housing and all the things that they would like to. That, you know, 2/3 of the seniors at 4-year colleges now hold student loans at an average of almost $29,000.
That's actually 100% correct, because, yes, it has a real economic effect, not only the debt, but Marty's right, it postpones things that you normally would do.
Yep. And one of the
last news item.
Well, one of the sports that we used to bash in terms of the dying numbers, it seems to be making a resurgence, and that's golf. It seems as though 2.6 million people have tried golf for the first time in 2018, and I think they've done a tremendous marketing job. I mean, they focused on youth golf. They focused on women's golf. I think golf clubs themselves have been a little bit more inclusive.
Maybe some of the golf executive should travel down and migrate to the MLB and do some of that.
There you go.
Good deal.
So let's go to some carnivore bites.
Okay. Well, we've got the U.S. Open. We're talking golf right now. The U.S. Open is taking place out at Pebble Beach. It's our last of the national, one of the big three, right? We got the British Open in a couple of weeks, and we got the Travelers next week. So what do you think about the U.S. Open following the Travelers golf tournament? What are your thoughts about that?
I think the U.S. Open's iconic.
Yeah.
You know, they have to be hoping that Tiger does well. I mean, he is still the biggest star.
He is the rock star.
You know, if I was a PGA executive, I would be like, what do you need? Anything you need, you know.
Yeah, right.
Absolutely.
Because if he could be in it to the end, the ratings skyrocket.
Right. How about the Dominican Republic? They've certainly been in the news for a lot of negativity.
Big Poppy. They think there might be a serial killer out there.
Wow. Is that what it is? Wow. Because I know there's been at least 8 to 10 tourists that have been killed.
They're thinking that it's not the whole picture, But some of it could be a crazy person.
Wow, that's amazing. And I know there's a lot of people are starting to rethink their vacation plans.
But we talked about it, you know, we hammered the media early. And so I get perplexed. I know we don't have a lot of time, but there were 13 Americans that died in the Dominican Republic in 2018. And there's six that have died as of today.
If a big poppy didn't get it, it wouldn't have made anything.
Yeah, but it had been percolating even before that. This Connecticut woman that alleges she got physically assaulted down there. But if you do 6 in 6 months, it's the same as 13, but we didn't hear anything last year. How is it that the media grabs hold of this? Now, every time somebody in the Dominican Republic stubs their toe, it's in the paper. Mm. I don't get it.
And yet we neglect, you know, Chicago.
Yeah.
You know, they're probably killing 13 people in a day.
I love, by the way, going to Dominican Republic. But the big poppy, but you know, one other thing you notice, a big poppy got shot. And do you know what happened next? The crowd beat the living stuffing out of the shooter, so much so that the police couldn't question him until he recovered from his wounds.
Wow.
If you look it up on the internet, find a picture of him. I'm not saying I'm in favor of that kind of stuff, but there's a certain charm to that justice.
I got it.
Yeah, absolutely.
So let's do two more carnivore bites.
Okay, well, let's go with something a little bit more, you know, fan-friendly, I guess. We have Father's Day coming up on Sunday. I know, Chris, you'll have a lot of love in your family.
Absolutely.
You know, your kids will be around. Hopefully I get a phone call. So Father's Day, you know, will be around. But you know what? I'm watching the news and I see Hong Kong. You know, when I was in Hong Kong in the 80s and they were projecting into the 1990s and they would have to give their land back to the Chinese and it was going to be two separate entities, it really has evolved almost to be a single entity. So there's a lot of people out there protesting. Yes. And there it could be another Tiananmen Square here in another 6 months.
One more news item. Or buzz item.
School vacation. You know, school ended today. Today was the end of my my career. I have 44 years of teaching. I retired today.
Congratulations.
And
congratulations.
School vacation is out. I know Mr. Sherman in Studio A is anxious to get on the golf course.
It's all good. Well, gentlemen,
absolutely.
That's a great show. We had two or three good callers. Go to WESUFM.org/pledge and make it happen. We'll be back next week with another edition of Carnivore Radio. You're listening to WESU. 88.1 FM in Middleton.